Greetings from Mumbai, India, and welcome to the Science Museum Group's Global Climate Talks, taking place throughout 2021 in the run-up to COP26, the most important international climate summit this year. As a United Nations Environment Programme Goodwill Ambassador, I'm honored to campaign on an issue that is close to my heart, the urgent need to protect our planet. The survival of animals, birds, insects, forests, lakes, and oceans depends on us. Every solution starts with a conversation. And by understanding the problems we face in the fight to tackle climate change, we can work together to solve those problems. That is why this series of climate talks is so important. The world is heating up to dangerous levels. And we're already over 1 degree Celsius above pre-industrial levels. According to the 2015 Paris Agreement, we have until the end of this decade to reduce carbon emissions to keep global heating to 1.5 degrees. Now, 1.5 degrees might not sound much, but the world's temperature isn't evenly spread, and some areas of the planet are heating up quicker than others. This is why we're already seeing more extremes in weather. More drought, coastal flooding, wildfires that have devastated ecosystems and communities. We must act now. If we fail to, it will get much worse. Which brings me back to why this series of climate talks is so important. These global online debates will explore not only the problems, but the solutions, be they nature-based, technological, behavioral, political, or economic. The series so far has examined climate justice, biodiversity loss, and the impact of capitalism on the environment. The talks so far have taken a global perspective. But tonight, the scope widens even further as we take a view from space and find out how our work in Earth's orbit and beyond has helped us to better appreciate and understand our precious and incredible planet and its changing climate. And now I'd like to introduce the chair of this evening's Climate Talk, the broadcaster, medic, and author, Dr. Kevin Fong.
Thank you to the multi-talented dear Mercer, an actor, film producer, and UN ambassador for introducing tonight's event from her home all the way from India. And hello and welcome to all of you watching at home. I am Kevin Fong, and I am delighted to be here for the latest in the Science Museum Group's series of global climate talks in the run-up to the most important international climate summit this year, the COP26. The Climate Talks series, which starts in January, runs throughout the year, and you can catch up with the ones you've missed on the Science Museum's YouTube channel. Before we start, I'd like to mention that live subtitles are available for this talk, which you can access by clicking the captions icon below. And the subject of today's Science Museum Group Climate Talks debate relates to how the work of humankind in space has advanced our understanding of planet Earth, our impact on the climate, and how the experience of our astronauts seeing Earth from space has enhanced our appreciation for the amazing, unique, yet fragile planet that we call home. So, without further ado, let's meet our guest speakers. This has got to be the most illustrious panel I have ever had the pleasure to chair. We'll start by welcoming all the way from Vienna, Simonetta Di Pippo, Director of the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs, Director of Human Spaceflight at the European Space Agency. Welcome, Simonetta.
Thank you.
Next.
My pleasure.
Great to see you. Next, we are joined by Dr. Maggie Aderin-Pocock, who needs almost no introduction, and certainly not for fans of the BBC's Sky at Night, of which she is presenter. Hi, Maggie.
Hi, lovely to see you.
And you. We're going to welcome the UK's very first European Space Agency astronaut, Tim Peake, who, of course, spent 6 months aboard the International Space Station before returning to Earth in 2016 in a Soyuz capsule that now resides in the Science Museum's Exploring Space Gallery. Hi, Tim.
Hello, Kevin, and hello to everyone watching. Great to be here.
Great to see you. And if that wasn't enough, and if one legendary British astronaut wasn't enough for you tonight, then it's good news because we have two. Welcome to the very first British astronaut, the first Briton in space, the amazing Dr. Helen Sharman, who is also the first woman to have visited the Mir space station in 1991. Hi, Helen.
Hi, Kevin and everyone.
Lastly, I should mention that Tim recently published his autobiography, Limitless, which is a cracking read, and there's a small number of signed copies of both Limitless and of Maggie's own book, The Sky at Night, Book of the Moon, from the Science Museum online shop in the link below. So very warm welcome to all of you. Thanks for joining us. And I think we're going to start with our two guest astronauts, Helen and Tim. Helen, Tim, I'm going to start with that quote from Carl Sagan that relates to the famous pale blue dot photograph taken from Voyager 1, one of my most favorite exploratory missions, at 3.8 billion miles from Earth. You're looking at it now. Sagan said, "There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known." And for good measure, I also thought we should have a look at the iconic Earthrise image. It's taken actually by astronaut Bill Anders aboard Apollo 8, although he had a lot of help from Jim Lovell. That's what Jim Lovell told me when I spoke to him last year in 1968. So, stunning images of the Earth from space. And I guess I want to ask, I'll start with you, Helen. You know, how much does that sentiment ring true to you? You know, having had the privilege of looking back at Earth from space, how much do Sagan's words ring with you?
That quote by Carl Sagan and you know, the bigger piece it comes from is, I think, one of the best ever written about human life on Earth. I mean, when you're inside a space station orbiting the Earth, whether it's the International Space Station now or Mir that I visited, you know, we go all the way around the Earth in 92 minutes. You know, one complete orbit, round and back. 92 minutes makes the Earth seem incredibly small. I mean, but it is beautiful. Nobody ever gets tired of it, I don't think. I mean, astronauts all just love looking out at those amazing views. We talk about those beautiful blue seas and the brilliant white clouds because the sunlight reflects off the top of them back up to us in space, those brick red deserts. And then, of course, if you look tangentially at an angle to the Earth, you can see through the Earth's atmosphere. And it is just such a very, very thin edge to our planet. And when you think that all life we know exists in this very thin strip on a very small planet, in the vastness of the universe, I think that makes our insignificance sort of even more striking. And obviously in such a small place like this, this thin line, I mean, everything is connected. It's obvious that it has to be. So you see swirls of plankton in ocean currents. You can see flashes of lightning in storms as they go from one part of the world to another in places that people on the ground couldn't even then perceive was another storm. You see the sediment from rivers coming out hundreds of miles into the sea. And I think that just shows that what we do absolutely impacts each other and other parts of the globe, and how much our atmosphere, because it's so thin, it can only absorb, you know, a certain amount before its equilibrium just gets pushed off balance. And you can see how, you know, how physically humans can be separated on Earth. We've got the mountain ranges, you've got the rivers and seas even, but what you don't see are those political boundaries, the things that Carl Sagan spoke about, you know, this idea of a social construct that defines somehow nation states that fight for their own interests to the detriment of the whole, just seemed, when I look back at the Earth, seemed to be such a crazy kind of concept. And yet I was seeing the oil fires in Kuwait burning in the aftermath of the Gulf War. You know, you don't normally see fires because they're too small. You see the smoke, it's in a straight line, but you don't see the fire burning. But I could see the Kuwaiti oil fires then. And I think, you know, our earthly lives are dictated more and more nowadays by these sort of political boundaries. If not just for travel and trade, it's how we use Earth's resources. And I always thought then, 30 years ago when I flew into space, but even more now, how it's time for our political leaders to see that bigger picture. You know, to it's important that we debate what we're doing now so that we do, well, we ask questions, we influence our leaders, we hold them to account, we have a democracy. I think the best we can do is actually to use it well.
I mean, that fragility of the atmosphere in that tiny thin layer around the Earth always takes my breath away. Charles Coquel, one of the astrobiologists from Edinburgh, talks about it as being not a biosphere, but a biosmear just smeared across the planet. Tim, how about you? How has your experience having flown in space, having seen the Earth from such an altitude, how has it shaped how you think about the Earth?
Yeah, I mean, just to reiterate and pick up on what Helen was saying there, I mean, it is incredible to see. And one of the interesting things is, you know, we go about our daily lives here and we're all very busy and the pace of change today is phenomenal. And, you know, we're actually losing touch with nature. We're becoming more and more disconnected, despite the fact we're surrounded by nature everywhere. And, you know, we're losing touch with what's above us as well. You look up on a bright, sunny day and you'll see a lovely, you know, blue sky here in the UK. It's probably grey and raining, but never mind. You know, what you're not seeing is you're not seeing the blackness of space, which is only, you know, 100 kilometres above you. And our atmosphere is only 16 kilometres thick. That's not even, you know, the distance from England to France across the channel. And space is a scary place. You know, when you are out there in this hostile environment that will kill you in less than 60 seconds, you know, you look at the Earth against this black, vast backdrop going on for infinity. And it is an environment that we do not want to find ourselves in. You know, we need to be thankful of those 16 kilometers that protect all life and enable all life here on planet Earth. And, you know, as Helen was saying, when you look tangentially at the Earth and actually every sunset and every sunrise, and we see 16 of them a day, so we get to see lots of this from the space station. There's a few special moments where Earth is completely black because you don't yet see the lights of towns and cities. And there are no stars yet because it's still too bright. But you just see this thin strip of Earth's atmosphere. And it's just the curvature of Earth and this beautiful prism of light against, again, this black backdrop. And that's when you think, wow, stunningly beautiful. But is that it? Is that all there is? And so it's very striking. And it gives you a completely different perspective on the fragility of you know, of our planet, depending on that atmosphere. I mean, I want to talk about quickly about life because, you know, we've just sent NASA's Perseverance rover off to Mars looking for the signs of life. But at the moment, we are, as far as we know, the only living or the only planet, rather, that can sustain and has sustained life. And I think that life gives meaning to the universe. I think a universe without life actually has no meaning. And that makes us, I mean, I completely agree with Helen, as she said, about our insignificance, because you feel completely insignificant. And when you see, you know, the photograph of Earth from Voyager, it makes you feel even more insignificant. But actually, life is something to be valued and life is something to be protected, because I think it's life that gives meaning to the universe.
And both of you have been scientists in space on board, you know, these ultimate scientific platforms, our space stations. Helen, you're on Mir. Tim, you're on the ISS. But Helen, tell us about the science that you did up there on the Mir space station and particularly about the climate-related experiments and observations that were done on that platform. Because, you know, it isn't all goofing around in weightlessness, is it?
We wish. But no, I think, I mean, everybody likes making themselves useful, I think. I did a variety of experiments, and I think really my mission was as much for the Soviet Space Agency to show off to the rest of the world all the different kind of science it does. So I had some plant growth stuff about looking at how potato roots grow and wheat seedlings and germinating seeds, looking at how my body was adapting to space flight and my crew's as well, looking at new materials, which is actually my favourite experiments because I got to use an airlock outside the space station so I could put these materials out and expose them to the vacuum and radiation of space and then bring them back in and analyse them and then transmit all that data back to Earth. So just a whole host of different types of experiments, protein crystals, you know, to look at future drugs for pharmaceutical companies. It's just great to be able to do that variety of different stuff. But I did a few Earth observation work myself. I mean, I was taking some ultraviolet images. We had a sapphire window, and it's probably where sapphire glass lets in a whole load of ultraviolet that the normal windows that we have in our houses doesn't allow through. And so we could get some great ultraviolet images of the Earth, but also looking at specific colours. And I had a very odd contraption that I could manipulate three different lights just to replicate certain colours of the Earth's surface. And the actual colour that my eyes perceived was very important to the scientists for them to be able to work out the kind of bacteria that was in a lake in Siberia, for instance. So yes, I was doing sort of a few Earth obs, but actually, you're right, the Mir space station itself really started sort of to accelerate, I think, the amount of Earth observation work that was being done at the time. Certainly after my mission, many sort of Earth observation experimental work was done in terms of looking at the change of land use on the Earth, ice melting, also long-term climate changes. They were looking at the events just before and during the 1997-1998 El Nino weather phenomena patterns and how all of that baseline data was changing. And then on the Perodra module in Mir, they had some equipment that could analyse changes in the biosphere and Earth's atmosphere, looking at seasonal changes and land and water as well. So there's a whole load of things, photographs in particular, you know, and there was, actually thought it was quite interesting, a combination of work with Mir astronauts as well as the Space Shuttle astronauts at the time. There's a big sort of Mir shuttle scientific program, but particularly to do with climate change. And there were a whole load of American satellites and equipment on the Mir space station, where they were sort of calibrated so the images could be comparable. And those were tens, hundreds of thousands of images that then formed a kind of an Earth observational database with data and images for scientists, researchers around the world to be able to call upon whenever they wanted. So, yes, that was, I think, the beginnings, really, of a really big database in Earth obs.
And talking about beginnings and the legacy of Mir, of course, it's great to move on to International Space Station. And Tim, your experience aboard it, what did you get involved in up there when you weren't doing Superman impressions? What climate-related science were you onto?
Yes, I mean, the space station, of course, is a microgravity laboratory. So we're involved in about, you know, anywhere between 250 and 350 experiments in a six-month mission. Now, a number of those will be climate related. Actually, the space station is not the best platform for Earth observation. We tend to use polar orbits for sun synchronous orbits, which are giving us, you know, more than 50% of all of our climate data. And I'm sure, you know, Maggie and Simonetta will probably come onto this as well. But even so, the space station has been giving some remarkable data back. It's inclined at about 51 degrees. So what that means is that in each orbit, as the Earth rotates underneath the space station's orbit, we actually cover about 90% of the populated area of the Earth. And we are able to monitor things like glaciers, you know, biomass, forested areas, urban areas as well, coral reefs, oceans. And something that we get involved in is CEO, this crew Earth observation. We're taking photographs that are sent up to us each day, areas of interest. And over a length of time, obviously, over 20 years we've occupied the International Space Station, we've been able to monitor significant impacts of climate change over that period by these crew observation photos. So, you know, the International Space Station is doing some really good work in terms of Earth observation. And what you get is the human element of seeing Earth from space and seeing the impact that humans are having on our planet. But actually, in terms of the quantity of data, the finger on the pulse, if you like, coming from space, the space station is just a very small part of it.
I mean, I always love the description of Earth observation. And in fact, one of my friends, Dan Tarney, was telling me about, he tried to snap a photo of London as he was going by for me. And he said, you know, it's moving by so fast that you have to sort of pan the camera as it's going. I always thought it was much easier than that. But an incredible, incredible perspective on the Earth there. And thanks to you both. For telling us about that, really inspiring. I feel very jealous now. We'll be coming back to you both a bit later, of course. But we're going to go to our next speaker now, joining us from Vienna, where she is director of the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs, which is the best named agency in the whole universe, I'm pretty sure. And it has the best abbreviation. It's also known as UNOOSA. I feel more relaxed from having said that already all on its own. This is Simonetta Di Pippo. A welcome, Simonetta. Lovely to see you. I just really wanted to start with you giving us an overview of your work at the United Nations Office for Outer Space Affairs. You know, I'm sure you must have a first contact team there that you can't tell me about, but what do you do?
Well, thank you, Kevin. Really, the work of the office is a rather broad interplay of various mandates, functions, and responsibilities. Well, if we want to frame it in an easy manner, I would say you can consider it working on two main lines. So, in reality, we manage and implement the program on the peaceful uses of outer space. So, you may say quite a broad mandate. What it means? The vision of the office is to really to bring the benefits of space to humankind, which is also quite broad. So in practice, in a nutshell, I can tell you that, first of all, we try to foster international cooperation with all the stakeholders in the space arena, which means governments, space agencies, NGOs, academia, the private sector, and the civil society. So quite a broad, environment. Secondly, you can consider us as, since we are the only UN entity fully devoted to space affairs, 100%, we are in a way the gateway in the system and for the system. So we coordinate UN activities also for all the other entities in the UN using space-related technologies to support their activities, and in particular, overall socioeconomic sustainable development. And in this particular side of the medal, what we do, we try to help all countries, especially in particular, developing and emerging countries, access to space and access to the benefits that space can bring for sustainable development. And this is at the core of our activities. So it's essentially capacity building activity, which goes from ranging from space law and policy, space applications, access to space infrastructures, et cetera. So if we go to the climate component, it's clearly embedded in all these activities. And just to make an example, we are running a dedicated program which builds capacity in utilizing space tools for disaster management and emergency response. And we are also developing a new initiative, which is called Space for Climate Action, which should provide opportunities to enable, develop, and inspire the use of space for the climate crisis, which is key for the future and to tackle the climate crisis. Without space, cannot be done.
And that's all important to remember, isn't it? That without space we can't tackle. I mean, is that really true? Without space we cannot tackle the climate crisis.
Well, I'm fully convinced about that. Just an example: if you look at the essential climate variables that's been classified by CEOs, which is the a group of space agencies. Well, 54 essential climate variables. You can monitor more than half of these variables only from space. And this is, it means that space is really mandatory to monitor and therefore to help humanity and all member states to take the right policy, the right policy and decision-making processes so that at the very end, we can understand better the mechanisms and then work better for adaptation and mitigation, which are the main activities that currently we are doing. My personal opinion is that we should bring back at the center science and space in this specific case. And I have to say also that the pandemic, the COVID-19 pandemic, is also going in the same direction. So science and space must be at the center. We need to understand all over the world, and really, as I say, policy makers need to understand this more than others, that without space, we cannot do really anything to tackle the climate crisis. That's also the message that I'm trying to bring through the system up to the COP26 at the end of this year.
Yes, I think if this past year has taught us anything at all, it's taught us how central science, technology, engineering, and mathematics have to be to the future of all of our policy, all of our planning. You know, it's yeah. right there in the middle, as you just said. Now, we just heard from Helen and Tim about, you know, the way they came to see the Earth and how it shaped their view of the Earth. You were the director of human spaceflight at ESA. Is that common? Do your astronauts usually come back changed in that way in their view of the Earth?
Well, clearly, what I can say is that my experience being always on the ground and helping the system, I mean, to really prepare missions and have astronauts flying, etc., it's in any case, it gives you a different perspective of the day-by-day life. I'm an astrophysicist by education. I've been spending all my time, 35 years now, in the space business in different, let's say, responsibilities. And what I can tell you is that my approach to life is strongly linked to space. It means that, in a way, if you made the reference to Carl Sagan and the fact that this pale blue dot, etc. So the Earth is a planet. And it's really small, quite a pale blue dot, if you look at it from a far distance. And so it means that in reality, we should also tackle the issues that in the day-by-day life with a different approach. And from space, in reality, you don't have boundaries. And you understand that you are in a sort of a spaceship altogether. This is something that astronauts always say. I mean, we are really all humanity on a spaceship Earth. I mean, floating in the floating is not exactly correct, but I mean, orbiting in the solar system. And to be very honest with you, I believe that also living with this approach is what brings us to do what we do, to work really hard to support humanity in understanding that without space, as I said, it's not possible any socioeconomic development. And we have also to look at space as a global common. And we have the duty to preserve Earth and space for future generations. Also, in particular, if we want to go and live on other planets and becoming a multiplanetary species. So in reality, as I said, even if I never flew, apart parabolic flights, it's extremely interesting that I've been dealing with astronauts all my life. I know so many that I probably don't even remember how many. But the point is that we all together in the space business, we see what we do as a service to humanity, which is extremely important. Each of us with a different perspective and a different, let's say, type of contribution.
And very, very briefly, Simonetta, before we move to Maggie, the United Nations is about to oversee the most important meeting on climate change on the whole planet this November, yeah. COP26 in Glasgow. Tell me very briefly what you think COP26 needs to achieve.
Well, as I said, we the Office for Outer Space Affairs this year are really focusing on climate crisis and climate action. And so for us, COP26 is really extremely important. What should, in my opinion, should achieve, and I believe that jointly Italy and UK did a great job this year in organizing both the COP26 Youth Summit, which is in end of September, beginning of October, and then the real COP26 later in the year. Also, the fact that we have for the first time the youth summit related to COP is extremely important because we need to bring the youngest at the table. We need to hear their voice. And so what we are trying to do also with other entities, including some UK-based organizations and including also the UK Space Agency, trying to bring the concept that space is at the center. Again, I'm sorry to repeat the same concept, but I believe that this is really important, and that's what we are trying to do. Eventually being present there with some side events, with some panel discussions, to bring all the main experts in the field to explain why it's so mandatory to use satellites to tackle the climate crisis.
Thank you so much. We'll be back with you very shortly, of course. But now we're going to hear from our next speaker, astrophysicist, author, broadcaster, serial overachiever and presenter of The Sky at Night, Dr. Maggie Aderin-Pocock. It's really great to have you with us, Maggie. I kind of want to talk to you about that bit of your life, which is designing experiments and doing science, and in particular, you've designed your fair share of instruments used in climate modelling, and particularly on one in particular on the European Space Agency's AEOLUS satellite. There's too many vowels in that name, AEOLUS satellite, which we've got a picture of here. Tell me a bit about that and your work with climate change in space.
So AEOLUS is a very exciting project. It was launched, I think, just over a year ago, and it's sort of getting data, yes, as you say, to help us understand climate change. So what AEOLUS does, actually, you mentioned the name AEOLUS. AEOLUS is actually the Greek keeper of the winds. So that's where the name hails from. And AEOLUS is doing something similar. It's giving us an understanding of the winds in our atmosphere. Now, winds play an important role in sort of linking weather cells together. So by understanding how the wind is changing and moving and doing things, we can get a better understanding of climate change. And so AEOLUS does this. It's quite challenging because when we're down here on Earth, we can interact with the wind. You can see wind socks and things like that. But when you're up there in space, you're sort of above most of the atmosphere. So AEOLUS measures wind speed by sending pulses of UV light down into the atmosphere. And then some of this UV light gets scattered off particles moving under the influence of the wind. And then some of that light is scattered back up to the telescope, which sits in AEOLUS, and that light is analysed. And the effect, you know, the Doppler effect, which elongates and sort of condenses light waves, sound waves and things like that. By actually analysing the light very, very carefully, we can see how that light has changed by the interaction with the particle it's been reflected off. And so that way we can get an understanding of wind speed throughout the atmosphere and at different altitudes. So it gives us, I think the plan is to have a number of AEOLUS satellites sitting there in space, looking down at our planet and giving us a better understanding of the wind and climate change.
And that's ESA, but what about the UK? We have our own UK Space Agency. What is it doing specifically on climate change?
Yes. And so there are a number of projects underway. Climate change is seen as a very high priority. And we do lots of things which involve Earth observation. So AEOLUS sort of measures wind speed in the atmosphere, but much of many of the satellites down out there are looking down at Earth and taking images of Earth and giving us a better understanding. And so with this, we get huge amounts of data. It's sort of, you know, big data is everywhere, and it's definitely out there in space. And so it's gathering this data and analysing this data and getting a better understanding, and then feeding this data into models and understanding how the Earth is changing, how the atmosphere is changing, and the impact this climate change is having. So yes, there's lots of funding going into various activities, but as well as that, lots of instrumentation being made to give us a better understanding, a better look. A few years ago, I was working on a project called FLEX, which actually looks at how plants photosynthesize. Because as plants photosynthesize, they absorb light, and through that they can make sugars, but they also re-emit light. And by looking at that light that's re-emitted, we can tell how efficient our plants are reacting. So there's all sorts of different ways we can use space to get a better understanding of our planet and help rather than sending sort of people out in cars and things like that, sort of burning fossil fuels, we can use space to give us that sort of that global picture. I think that's the glorious thing that space gives us, that sort of global picture. And that means that we're not working in isolation, sort of one country here, one country there. We're working together on a united problem.
And it's not just looking at Earth that helps us with climate, is it? Our immediate neighbours on either side tell us something about what the future of climate might look like. They're sort of almost a cautionary tale. Tell us a little bit about looking at the other planets in our solar system.
Yeah, I do love that, because usually when we think of sort of climate change, we think sort of locally, we look sort of Earth observation. But as you say, looking at our sort of sister planets gives us a lot of information. If you look at sort of Mercury is sort of very close to the sun, a sort of a lump of rock, not that interesting. Although, sorry to all sort of people studying Mercury. But sort of moving further out, sort of Venus is a fascinating planet. Many people would have seen Venus in the night sky, sort of either first thing in the morning or sort of last thing at night, just as the sun has set. And Venus has a very thick, tumultuous atmosphere with very high levels of carbon dioxide and other climate-inducing chemicals. And so by understanding sort of the atmosphere of Venus, and by actually having sort of satellites in orbit around Venus, and actually sort of probes landing on the surface of Venus, we can get a better understanding of that atmosphere. If we go to the other side, sort of further away from the sun, to Mars, that's where sort of, Percy the rover is sort of trundling over the surface now. And by looking at Mars, we believe that Mars used to have liquid water flowing over the surface. So Mars was much more Earth-like in the past, but some sort of, I won't say climate catastrophe, but the climate changed radically. And so by looking at sort of this planet, we can understand what happened to Mars. There are various theories abound, but by studying these other planets, it gives us insight into perhaps the fate of our own and lessons learned. But also by looking at the atmospheres of these other planets, atmospheric modelling is a challenging thing to do. As both Tim and Helen said, our atmosphere is a thin band around our planet, and yet it's a chaotic system. And having just one planet to look at limits the extrapolations we can do. But by looking at other planets with atmospheres, Venus and Mars, it actually feeds into the climate change models and gives us a better understanding of our atmosphere. So I think we have a lot to learn by looking sort of further afield out to our sister planets.
Perseverance and ingenuity on Mars is my favourite mission of the moment. So fantastic, really wonderful. The Pentagon recently successfully tested a satellite solar panel that can beam solar energy down to Earth, which I'm sure was the plot of one of the James Bond movies, but never mind. What can you tell us about this? This is a real experiment. So is this a future solution for clean energy?
There are a number out there. This is a very exciting one, because you can go out there into space, grab that solar energy and beam it back to Earth. There were plans a little while ago to actually put solar panels on the moon made out of the lunar regolith. So sort of send autonomous robots out there. They build these solar panels. There are some parts of the moon that sort of get almost 24/7 daylight. If you are actually scooping up some of this solar energy from these solar panels and then finding ways to beam it down to Earth, again, finding ways of sort of tackling the climate change problem here by finding cleaner solutions to energy. So I think space can teach us so much, and there's so many different ways we can use it.
Well, thank you so much, Maggie. That is fascinating. Could talk to you all night about all of that. It's really exciting. Now, listen, I'm going to bring the rest of the panel back now for an open discussion. And would also like to hear some of the questions that were sent in by our audience. So I'm going to direct the questions around to specific speakers, but if anyone wants to interject, just give me a wave and I'll bring you in. But we are going to start with a question to Simonetta. And I think I want to ask, what, Simonetta, do you think the future of climate research in space is going to look like?
Well, yeah, very good question. Thank you. So the climate research in space, I would say, is already in quite good shape. And more missions are planned with focus on climate and weather-related aspects. So For example, there is a mission in UK under the responsibility of the European Space Agency to enable better performance of Earth observation satellites and their ground segments. And this will contribute to better inform, to better inform decision-making processes around climate adaptation strategies, which is extremely important. And if we look at the Copernicus program, we would see several new Sentinel satellites in the next coming years, each bringing new capabilities, such as tracking individual sources of anthropogenic emissions, improving observations of land, ice, oceans, and supporting forest management and a lot more. And if we look at NASA also, there are a lot of missions already current and in planning, focusing on increased accuracy of climate-related measures. And this will really be a revolution in measurements of atmospheric chemistry and even seek to make the first ever global survey of the surface water on Earth. Well, we have also to consider, and this is extremely important to consider, that in addition to government missions, we have a lot of private sector entities which are entering the race in recent years. And so we see constellations of small satellites which offer great prospects for near real-time coverage of the Earth. And so we have measurements from this new type of constellations, which are going to complement high precision satellites. So unlocking great potential in combining various data sources resulting from this new approach. Well, this for sure, and this is, my heart, this require a really a high degree of international cooperation, because we need to make available to everyone all the data which are collected in an open and free way. And this is also linked to data standardization, because otherwise, if we don't have standards, then it will be difficult to utilize this data. And so if we make the best possible use of space-based data and infrastructures and the benefits that they offer, well, we can also help all countries to benefit from this for an improvement of their well-being. And then I believe also that it's extremely important that when we analyze the data and we translate this data into actionable solutions, we really need the integration with new technologies. And so the more we integrate the new technologies, artificial intelligence, including machine learning, but also biotechnologies and robotics, and we integrate these technologies between them, but also with space technologies, well, for sure, we will have an improvement in the way we can utilize space also in this field. And we really believe that using more and more artificial intelligence and supercomputers, and so big data, we can really use data for transforming the future and helping, as I said, humanity for a better future.
Thank you so much. I want to throw that also to Maggie. Because you told us something about some pretty far flung science at the end of your little section there. But what else do you think the future of climate change science in space looks like?
Well, one of the things we've talked about is sort of using space to get sort of better understanding of climate change, to develop better models. But space is doing so much more than that, as well as sort of mitigating and sort of making it easier or to spend to consume less fuel on Earth. Space is also helping us when climate change disasters happen. So, and when sort of as more disasters sort of hit us, space can help us with understanding them, help with satellite phones to sort of communicate people who are stranded, help, my favorite example is in sort of Hurricane Katrina in New Orleans, images from space through Earth observation were able to help people get to the right areas or sort of send supplies in the right direction because they had that sort of, again, that sort of top level view. So it's not just about getting the data, it's also sort of mitigating against the impact of climate change too.
We've got a question here about how we behave in space, really, and whether the amount of litter there is. I'm just going to pull that up. Sorry. I can get my screen to work. So Kian is asking, how do you, Lucille is asking about how much litter we're depositing in space, and is this something we should be looking at reducing? And similarly, Flora asks, can we really retrieve all the litter we've left in space, and has it been worth it? I want Helen to answer that. I think these questions are coming from primary five at Min's primary school. I think that's right. So yeah, those are good questions. And I remember reading that the last thing that Apollo astronauts did before they left the moon was lob all of the spare stuff out of the cabin so they were light enough to get into lunar orbit. So it's not great, is it? So Helen, is it worth it? Are we littering up there?
Well, I think littering is a very good word because it's quite demeaning, really, isn't it? It's and it's something that we've been doing for a long time now. We often use this a word debris, if you're perhaps more American, but space debris is what we call really all this litter. And yeah, I think I'm going to start calling it litter now. I think that's a much better word for it. It's made up of some huge bits, like say dead satellites. So of course we've been sending satellites into space now for a very long time, decades. There's a few thousand that are now dead. But there are more ones that are now not in use. Not really, never really alive, are they? But the ones that aren't in use are called dead ones. There are more that are dead than are actually alive, interestingly. But also, it's not just these big lumps of old satellites, which are basically litter. They're junk. They're huge, though. Some of them are like tons in weight, like as big as an elephant. But also, there's all of these, the smaller bits that are actually really dangerous. Big bits you can monitor, right? And we do actually have lots of times when spacecraft, whether they're satellites or a space station with the astronauts, we have to maneuver around these bits of space junk, the debris, the litter. But all the other bits, I mean, there are 34,000 pieces, probably more now, of big lumps that are between 1 centimetre and 10 centimetres big, you know, 34,000 of them. There are millions that are less than a centimetre. So millions and millions that can be made of spent rocket stages and bits of frozen fuel. What else? I mean, dust, really, fragments, effects of paint, and they can really damage other spacecraft out there. So, yeah, so there is a thought, you know, what do we do with these things? So historically, what we often do is ship them up into a very, very high orbit, really high. So there are two big places around the world where a lot of this debris is, all this litter. One's in low Earth orbit, where the space station is with the astronauts, and the other tends to be much higher up, where we've got what we call geostationary satellites. So they're going around the Earth at just the same rate that the Earth is turning. So they're always looking at the same spot. So they're 36,000 kilometres up. So two big places. So we can actually ship these dead bits of satellites before they completely die really, really high up so they don't get in the way. But that's just putting off the problem. We can try and bring them back closer to Earth so eventually they burn up in the Earth's atmosphere. That can be quite useful. But even then, you know, they can sometimes break up. They don't always come back properly. We're now trying to look at what can we do with the bits that we haven't done that to. Can we send a harpoon out and sort of and somehow lock onto them and then grab them back to bring them back to Earth, or a big net, possibly, using magnets or a laser to kind of try and slow them down a bit. So there's lots of work, but there's nothing that really works yet. So I think Simonetta can probably comment on the United Nations. I think the United Nations would like us to send everything 25,000 kilometres up, but I don't think we can actually enforce that, can we, Simonetta? Is that right?
No, we can't. And the point is that in reality, there are the so-called space debris mitigation guidelines already approved by member states of the Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space since long. And a couple of years ago, COPIUS approved a good set of long-term sustainability guidelines. And space debris, again, is one of the main topics. Now, by the way, the Office for Outer Space Affairs, we are currently working with the UK government through the UK Space Agency, exactly on this topic. And it's quite a strong collaboration. And we have also an agreement with the European Space Agency. We have currently a campaign ongoing to increase awareness on the importance of looking at space debris seriously, because what we experience is that while usually governments and satellite, say managed by space agencies and government, governments are really following the space debris mitigation guidelines, we also have to consider that, first of all, we have a lot of new countries entering into the space arena. And on top of that, a lot of private, non-state actors. And so what we really need to foster is to bring them to understand that they need to start their activities in the space field with a responsible behavior. Because even if we want to develop the so-called commercial space, so being able to develop the private sector and use space also for socioeconomic development in space, well, what we really need is to have all the players following the rules and the rules of the road. Otherwise, it will never happen that we can maintain space for peaceful purposes and for future uses. And I have to say, these guidelines are not mandatory, are really, in a way, how can I say, soft law, because they're not committing. But at the same time, the process that we use in Vienna is everything is approved by consensus, which means that all member states, and we have 95 member states in the Committee on the Peaceful Uses of Outer Space, they really approve everything by consensus. So the 21 guidelines on the long-term sustainability and also the space debris mitigation guidelines have been approved by consensus. So everyone is really committed to follow. And this is extremely important because it's the international cooperation and the common understanding that what we are trying to do all together is for the benefit of everyone.
Thank you, Simonetta. So we've got a huge raft of questions to get through, and we're on number two, so I'm failing. So I'm going to have to ask you to have some quick fire answers here. But Tim, I just wanted to come to you now, really, to talk about whether or not you think spaceflight needs to be more sustainable. I mean, we're starting to see reusable rockets, but is there a future where, well, does it need to be greener? Is there a future in which it's greener? What do you think to that?
Yes, I think it does. You know, I think to put it into context, though, a lot of people see rockets launching and they just think, oh, my God, look at that carbon footprint. To put it into context, you know, we launch about 100, 120 rocket launches every year. Just take SpaceX Falcon 9. I did the back of the cigarette packet maths today. And, you know, that's got 155 tons of kerosene. A ton of kerosene gives about 3 tons of carbon. So you've got 465 tons of carbon there. And then liquid oxygen as well, 362 tons, doesn't obviously produce any carbon when it's burned, but in producing liquid oxygen, storing it, transporting it, worst case scenarios, if you use fossil fuels for that, you've got about 650 tons there. So total, one Falcon 9 SpaceX rocket launch is about 1,100 tons of CO2. That's about 5 trips, one-way trips across the Atlantic in a 747. It's insignificant in comparison to commercial aviation, for example. So just to put things in proportion, because a lot of people say about things like the cost of human spaceflight, for example, without knowing what the cost is. So let's talk about the carbon footprint. It's incredibly insignificant compared to something like agriculture or commercial aviation. But that's not to be flippant, and that's not to say that we can't do more to reduce it. Rocket launches are going to increase in the future. We've got some brilliant new space companies that are looking at this, like Skyrora, for example, have Ecocene. They use non-recyclable plastic, so rather than it going to landfill, they can take non-recyclable plastic, which burns 45% less CO2 than kerosene. We've got Orbex, who are looking at biopropane. So it's great that new space are really putting the environment at the top of their agenda. SpaceX, we've seen recycling parts of their rocket. Great for commercial because it's brought the cost of access to space down, but also great for the environment, of course. Yes, we can do more. And yes, we are doing more. And I think we're going to see space getting greener and greener as in the future. Sorry, Kevin, that wasn't that short.
No, that's good. That's good. I'll tell you off later. And Helen, let me talk to you about space tourism. You know, it's a very recent innovation, but do you think that's going to help us or hurt us, or is it indifferent to climate change?
I think it will help us in the end, because I think, as Tim said, the actual impact of rockets on the atmosphere is very, very small at the moment. And yet the space tourism is going to come on the back of a lot of the commercial space flight, which, as we heard from Tim, is already looking at reusing rockets and looking at different kind of perhaps even different engines as well. So I can imagine something with perhaps with an air breathing engine, a bit like we've got with Skylon. It air breathes and perhaps it uses wings as lift as well. So we're kind of getting all of this kind of stuff, which tourism helps to develop these kind of technologies, which also reduces the cost and increases access to space for all sorts of people. And I can see a few tourists actually helping that access to be increased for scientists. So it might not just be people like Tim and possibly myself who have gone into space as an astronaut, but you might go into space as an employee of your company. Let's say you've got a pharmaceutical company and you want to do some more protein crystal work to design more drugs. You send your own member of staff into space to do that. And I can see because it's going to be easier and cheaper to do that, to investigate household products, flame retardants, fire retardants, that kind of thing, the kind of thing we can do in space. So I can see actually a few tourists helping that access to space, which will improve our science and ultimately our understanding of the environment. So they could actually be overall quite useful.
Thank you, Helen. Now, next questions, and there are several, I'd like to direct to Maggie and Simonetta. They come from, well, so I was wrong earlier. It's actually only this question that comes from the primary five at Mearns Primary School, which was, the question was, what evidence of climate change can we see from space? But there are several related questions. Laura is asking, has there been any observable difference in appearance of the planet from space due to and during the pandemic? And similarly, Josh and Gracie are asking, how much change could be seen from the International Space Station over the last year during lockdown? So I think, you know, this is a sort of remote sensing, sort of remote observations question in the first part, I think. So Maggie, let's start with you, and then Simonetta. What, if anything, have we been able to see from space because of the lockdown, because of the pandemic?
So due to the pandemic, we've been travelling, that's a lot less sort of air travel, fewer of us are driving around in our cars, and this should have an impact, but I think for climate, our atmosphere responds slowly to these changes. So I think if you're sitting on the International Space Station sort of when lockdown happened, I don't think it's like, wow, that's so much clearer. And it's quite similarly, as a stargazer, I've sort of been going out at night in the clear night, and I'm not saying, wow, the skies are so much clearer, because these things take sort of time to embed and change. So I don't think we are seeing sort of that sort of impact, or the impact of COVID on our environment. But there is lots that we can observe from space. A few years ago, I was looking at a project where I was going to get kids to sort of measure sort of lakes across the world and see how they're receding with climate change, or look at sort of some of the polar ice caps and see how they're changing. So things like that, it's very useful to monitor them from space. But I think the direct impact of COVID, we haven't really seen that yet. And because the climate is so complex and so chaotic, I don't think it's instantaneous that way.
Simonetta?
Well, yeah, I absolutely agree. What I can tell you from another angle is that among others, we have a program called SPIDER, which is dealing with helping member states in getting space-based data and services to tackle the disaster cycle and the emergency response phase. And this was mentioned already, that clearly with the climate change and the climate crisis, I would call it, disasters are becoming more and more extreme. And on top of that, you have to consider that we made some preliminary evaluations on the impact of a natural disaster on on a population, on communities which are already extremely touched by the pandemic. The combination of the two can be observed from space, and this helped us a lot in particular in the emergency response phase, which is extremely important if you want to save a certain amount of life In addition to that, what I strongly believe is that we need to prepare to what we call the build back better. So the phase in which the post-pandemic phase, where we really want to build back better. I mean, towards what we call the new normal, whatever it is. But for sure, we will have to think about the future of jobs in this new situation. And space, again, combined with climate and how space can support climate, all together can really help in this approach of building back better. So using this situation to help populations and communities around to use other tools, in particular the space-related tools, to improve the quality of life. And so also space economy can really become quite a good tool for what the World Economic Forum calls the Great Reset after the pandemic.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Now, one for Helen and Tim, at least in Sheffield, is asking, what is the one thing a primary or secondary school child can do if they want to be an astronaut? That same question was asked by a tired doctor in London called Kevin as well.
Yeah. Shall I go as first as it? So Sheffield, okay. My hometown.
You go first,
And then Tim, I'm sure you'll have loads of extra stuff as well to add. So I think for the foreseeable future, you still need to have those science subjects at school that will lead to all sorts of science, technology, engineering and maths. They are still going to be the subjects that will drive an awful lot of our requirements in space. Not all, but most. So if you like science, then just keep on being curious about that, and that's going to be really great. But the other thing is, of course, just, you know, keep fit and healthy, so a good diet and exercise. The main thing about being in space, though, is that it's not just about doing experiments. You've got to work with a whole load of different people, your space crew, mission control, the other scientists, doctors, including people like Kevin, and all sorts of people, right? So you've got to be able to get on well with a variety of different people in stressful situations. So if you enjoy playing with all sorts of different types of friends, you enjoy doing games like, let's say, netball, football, you might want to join an orchestra, do things that keep you working and playing together. And they're all really, really useful. Join the cadets, go to Brownies. They're great stuff to get you working with different types of people. And having good skills with your hands, you know, so to be able to do fine work, even in a spacesuit, it's quite useful. So if you enjoy a craft or maybe playing a musical instrument that keeps this manual dexterity, we call it, that's all really useful. Tim, I'm sure you can think of loads more.
You know, I've got hardly anything to add to what Helen said there. She covered loads of it. The only thing I'd also say is that no space agency that I know of recruits anybody out of school. So it's important to think about what are you going to do before you become an astronaut, and try and find something you're passionate about that, you know, that you can put all of your energy and enthusiasm into. Because to be a good astronaut, everything that Helen said, plus operational experience in your field. But I'm sat here, you know, we've also got Simonetta sat here, and I was on the other end of one side of the table during my selection process, and Simonetta was the director of human spaceflight on the other side of the table. So I think we should ask Simonetta, what were you looking for in 2008?
If you want, I can tell you. I have to say, I am allowed to give you a little bit of history of what happened. When I took up duty as director of human spaceflight, which was in May 2008, just a few weeks ago, a few weeks before, the call for new astronauts was already issued. So when I arrived, I found the situation quite already, let's say, running, okay? And the call was looking for four new European astronauts. And then, I don't know, Tim, if I ever mentioned this to you, but what happened was that I, being the director, we got more than 8,400 valid applications. And then they went, I mean, all these people went through a long selection process, which was handled by the European Astronaut Center. And so I jumped into the process at the very end, because after the test with the Russians, I mean, the medical tests, out of 55, they became 22. So I was chairing the panel, and they were 22, and Tim was part of the 22. And so we went through these interviews, and at the end of these interviews, I went back home with all the dossier, and I spent a week weekend thinking, okay, but why I have to hire four of them? I see as a minimum six of them outstanding, and one of them was Tim. And you know, it was difficult because I had four. What to do? So I talked to the Russians. I talked to the Americans. I said, okay, but if at the very end I select six of them, can we find additional flight opportunities? Can you invent something? Because, you know, hiring an astronaut without having flight opportunities is not a good approach. And so then I was able to convince the at that time, Director General of the European Space Agency, and we got six, including Tim. And I remember that, the UK was not participating to the space station, to all the activities under human space flight. So I was quite brave in doing so, I have to say, but I was fully convinced that it was a great future astronaut. And I believe I was right, Tim?
Well, I can't thank you enough, Simonetta, for what you did. So wonderful stuff.
My pleasure.
Excellent, excellent. I've taken all that advice, Helen. I realise now I should have joined the brownies. That's what I should have done. So Maggie, one for you here. A quick one for you. I'm really interested to know your opinion on. So increasing talk, of course, about colonising Mars by the likes of Elon Musk. So two questions for you quickly. Is that feasible in the event that our planet became uninhabitable, and is it ethical?
So brilliant questions. I'm just taking notes too, because I'd so like to be an astronaut, but moving on. Actually, I applied when Tim applied, so yes. Anyway,
some of us did as well, yeah.
Yeah, we'll keep it quiet. But the astronaut, they're looking for more astronauts, so it's a good time. So looking at Mars, there is a challenge of getting to Mars, but I don't think at the moment it's a technical one. At the moment, one of the biggest challenges is the cost of getting people to Mars. So I think we have enough technology and enough understanding that we can sort of travel at the right time so they don't get sort of too much solar radiation. We can get people to Mars and bring them safely back. But I think the biggest challenge at the moment is finding the funds to do that. And it's quite interesting because different people across the world, like sort of at NASA and sort of the European Space Agency, sometimes they're looking at the moon and sometimes they're looking at Mars. And it sort of flip-flops between the two. Should we go back to the moon or should we just head on to Mars? So this has been going on for a while, but it's quite interesting. Some of the sort of commercial companies out there who were saying now, no, let's get people to Mars. On the second side of sort of a, should we do it? I think that's a fascinating question. And when I go out to schools and give talks, it's something I like to say, because I think it's always as if we've had a wild party here on Earth. It's like, whoa, we've trashed the place. And we're sort of looking around a bit embarrassed. And so, hey, should we go to the next room? And I think there are so many lessons that we need to learn here on Earth before we start talking about sort of going to Mars. So I think it is feasible. I think we'll see it hopefully in the next sort of, I'm an optimist, I'd like to say the next 10 years. But I think there are so many lessons that we need to learn here rather than take our bad habits to Mars.
Thank you so much, Maggie. Now, I've just got time to squeeze this question in. Really quick thoughts from all of you, but I really want to ask this question to all of you. So we're near the end, but I wanted to talk about all of your public engagement work. Maggie's Science Innovation Organization, Helen as an Outreach Ambassador for Imperial College, Tim as well, who did a Q&A with school children from the Science Museum Group and toured with the Soyuz. And of course, yeah, we all, both of you, Helen and Tim, featured on the Christmas lectures that I did in 2015. So I want to ask how important you think it is that climate change itself should become embedded in the school curriculum. Who wants to start? I'll start with Helen on that one.
So I think there's a few things. The Department for Education will say, well, actually, we already have a bit of climate change in the curriculum. And if you look hard, you can find a bit. There's some GCSE geography, which is specific on climate change. There's other stuff, sort of at different levels. I think there's something about certainly about the carbon dioxide that we put into the atmosphere and its effect on greenhouse effect, and that it's probably human origin. But actually, I think most teachers would say that they include climate change in a lot of their subjects. You'll find a drama teacher, for instance, will say that, or else it'll be in some sort of community, sort of social kind of lessons. They have different acronyms depending on sort of which part of the country you're in sometimes. But there's, I think, a lot of times that they are kind of included, but it's not actually part of the curriculum. Now, I would say we need to teach science because we need to have the broad level of science to be able to understand different parts of this climate change. So I think we teach science, but perhaps, yes, we include climate change in these other aspects, like the kind of the social, the cultural development kind of parts of school. Perhaps if we make climate change and mandatory to be part of those lessons, then for the odd few schools that aren't doing it, that would encourage them to get it in.
Thank you. Tim, and then Maggie, very quickly.
Yeah, I mean, very good. When I go around speaking to children of all ages, actually, I'm noticing more and more, the climate is something that they're passionate about. You're pushing on an open door when you speak to young students about climate change and what we can do for the environment. Yes, it does need to be part of the school curriculum, but like Helen said, it needs to be underpinned by science. And then it's a great topic to be debated. In terms of it's one of the greatest challenges that we face, and our younger generation are going to have to deal with this, finding solutions. But I firmly believe, I'm an optimist, but I also firmly believe science and technology are at the heart of our solutions. So it's something that has to be, taught from the basics.
Maggie?
So I agree with both Helen and Tim. I think that climate change should be part of the curriculum. I do like Helen's idea where it is embedded as part of a sort of different subjects. So we're tackling it in different ways. But I totally agree with him. I think kids are fired up about it and they're also worried about it. But I think also an understanding of climate change and the science behind it can help open doors. Kids sort of see this as a challenge of the future. And I think it might sort of encourage more kids to get into science, to take on the challenge. So I think it can work in a multifaceted way.
Thank you so much. Now, we're really, really nearly at the end, but we've done fantastically so far for keeping to time. I just want a last very, very quick fire round from all of you. And I want all of you 1 minute each, please, on the most important lesson that your work or indeed in space has taught you about the Earth's environment and climate change. So I'm going to come back to you, Helen, again to go first on this one. So 1 minute on what you think that
okay,
is.
Okay, 1 minute. I shall keep an eye on the time. I think for me, it was that interconnectedness of seeing how obviously the space station, our effects on the space station and our little tiny microclimate, and therefore extrapolating that into this tiny bit of the Earth, but also knowing that often when human beings don't see something right in front of their faces, individuals and companies can be actually very selfish. So then I come back to that concept of that weirdness, looking back on the Earth and thinking about these sort of these nation states, our governments and so on. And we do require a government's, I think, international agreements now to get those frameworks into use so that we do have best practice. They're promoting sustainable use of the world's resources. And we all adhere to regulations that mean that we can work and play nicely.
Thank you. Maggie?
So I'd like to go back to something you were talking about at the beginning of this conversation, which is the image of Earthrise. Because even today, when I see that picture, it gives me goosebumps. And I think Earthrise, many people think that's spite the environmental movement. So I think we should be, sort of broadcasting that, letting people see our amazing, our beautiful planet, but showing people that it's vulnerable and that it needs our help and support. We take it so much for granted. I think that things like Earthrise can really help us with that. But I think there's so much we can do from space to help with that as well, with Earth observation, with getting energy from further afield. We talk about sort of mining asteroids or helium-3 on the moon. There are there's so many different ways that help space can help us. So I think, but we need the next generation of space scientists and space engineers and astronauts coming through. So I think we should be using imagery like that to really inspire the next generation to help take on some of these challenges.
Thank you. Simonetta.
Well, two main elements. The first one is the inspirational side of it and the fact that, looking at the Earth from outside and working in this field, it gives you the feeling that the approach to life must be holistic and must be really, you need to take all the various elements, psychology, neuroscience, STEM education, everything all together. And this is important because space is innovation by definition. It helps to really develop socio-economic manner in all countries, because we have to focus a lot on emerging and developing countries. And the other side of the medal is, again, science at the center. Without science at the center, humanity cannot survive. I hope that this lesson is a lesson that all of us will be able to bring everywhere to everyone to have real humanity understanding this key elements for our future.
Thank you, Simonetta. Tim?
None of this is going to work unless we collaborate. We have to work together. Everybody has to do their bit. And that's not just every nation, it's every individual. But as Simonetta picked up on as well, it's every corporation, it's every non-state actor. Everybody has to take responsibility for the impact that they have. And I love the fact that tonight's discussion has been quite broad. We haven't just focused on climate change. We've spoken about Mars. We've spoken about space. These are equally important environments. We have to protect space for our younger generation. It's going to be so much more important in the future. And so it's about collaboration. We have to transcend political differences, economical difficulties, and we have to protect our planet, our environments for future generations. And I think just to end on a quote from Tanya Steele, who is the UK head of the World Wildlife Foundation, who said that we are the first generation to know that we're destroying the world, and we're the last that can do anything about it. And I think that really brings home the responsibility that we have to act.
Thank you, Tim. Really important words there. Okay, well, we are at an end here. Thank you so much. I hope all of you watching at home will agree that it's been absolutely fascinating. It certainly has been for me to hear about our research in and around Earth's orbit and beyond, and how that's helping us to tackle the urgent issue of global climate change. Thanks so much. It's been an absolute pleasure to be here for our guests this evening with Simonetta Di Pippo, Maggie Aderin-Pocock, Helen Sharman, and Tim Peake. So thanks to you all and the audience, without whom it would have been worth nothing. So thanks for joining us. If you found this discussion inspiring, there are many more climate talks debates throughout 2021 in the run-up to and beyond COP26. You can catch up on the ones you've missed on the Science Museum's YouTube channel. And the next event in this series is on the 31st of March. It will examine the subject of greenhouse gas removal by way of engineered or nature-based solutions. Find out more about the rest of the climate talk series and book a free ticket by clicking in the link below. Finally, if you'd like to support the Science Museum Group's mission to inspire the next generation of scientists, engineers, and mathematicians, not to mention future climate scientists, you can also find a link to make a donation in the description below. And that concludes today's Science Museum Group Climate Talks debate. So stay safe, take care. Thank you so much for joining us. I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Thank you.